I think making music is like making love anyway, so.
Thank you. know how you feel. Yes, I do. Because I feel it too.
Something like 5 or 6 years, right, Tina, since the last Tom Tom Club album, but there are many good reasons for this. Number one, we have this other band called Talking Heads, and Talking Heads still makes records, so we had a couple of Talking Heads records to do, and a couple of tours also. That takes up a lot of time. And we also had two children born in that period. One is our son Robin, he's right over there. The other one's Egan, he's age 2. So we had to spend some time, you know, taking care of our children, and we still do. But we also do things like produce Ziggy Marley. We've produced 2 albums by Ziggy Marley now in that same period of time. So while it might have looked like Tom Tom Club wasn't doing anything, it's only because we realized that, you know, to do something right, you have to really spend, you have to have the time to do it properly. And we didn't want to do Tom Tom Club and just sort of like throw something out there and see if it hit. We wanted to develop it as a band and, you know, really take the time to do it carefully so that it has some lasting meaning to people and not just something that gets cranked out.
For Rock and Rio with the B-52s. Chris and I were their extra guns to make a very exciting show because we were playing in front of a lot of people. And we were very excited to come here because we'd only known about Brazil from the movies and from songs and TV. And of course, it was completely different from what we had imagined. What most impressed us when we arrived was how intelligent and warm the people are here. It was amazing to us, who do not speak a word of Portuguese, that everyone could sing along to the songs in English. That made a big impression. Of course, we were only here for 10 days, and because it was right at the time when everyone was in samba school, preparing for carnival, we did not get to go to see any Brazilian bands, but we kept wanting to come back since we were children all our lives. I remember growing up in the, what was really big in the 60s was Astrud Gilberto singing The Girl from Ipanema. And that was our first impression. Of course, this was, I imagine, before you had all these hotels here, and there was beautiful beaches, and it was very wild back then. And but that was our first impression as children growing up about Brazilian music. And then we would hear about Carnival, and people who would come to Carnival would bring back photographs of everybody dressed up enjoying it. Then as we got older, we started to get exposed to other kinds of Brazilian music, like Gilberto Gil. Gaetano, Veloso. We've been listening to their records for a long time. Last night, for the first time, we actually got to see Gilberto Gil in concert, and it was incredible. He's even better live than on his records, and he was always such an original singer to me. His style is so sophisticated and yet so free and loose. Thank you. It's also where I met David Byrne, but I was friends with Chris for 2 years before we started to get very serious about each other. And we shared a painting studio together. And this is where David Byrne came to us and said, I've got an idea for a song about a psycho killer. Can you help me out? So we started throwing out lyrics, and he said, maybe, Tina, you can contribute some French lyrics because I want to create a kind of split personality, and I think the best way to do this is to use two different languages. So we did that. And it was a lot of fun. At the same time, David and Chris formed a band in school that they played in, and I encouraged them to move to New York and to continue playing music, even though they were artists. It was something we'd all of us had always played music.
Thank you. is the only place left, but I think we came for the women. I think that's one of the main reasons we came. No, we came because it was someplace different, and we heard that this is the place with the rhythm of life.
The idea was that it would be kind of a club where members could come and go, and it wasn't really fixed as any one thing. And we didn't want to call it, you know, Chris France and Tina Weymouth or Tina and Chris, because we didn't particularly want to just draw attention to ourselves. We wanted it to seem like a group effort, which making a record almost always is. And one thing led to another, and now we're six people, more or less permanent, three men, three women, and we're performers, and we're having a really good time. Ciao. One thing that Talking Heads and Tom Tom Club have in common, besides Tina and myself, is this, and I think we learned it in art school, and it was instilled in us then that while it's okay and perfectly acceptable to draw from outside influences and to derive ideas from other people that have done things before you, like James Brown, like the Beatles, like the Who, like, Caetano. It's okay to draw ideas from them, but you should also contribute something that's unique and personal to yourself, and that's how you make it your art. You don't, no way are you going to sound better than Mick Jagger if you're trying to be Mick Jagger. So what we try to do is, we try to get the, if we like the feel of somebody like James Brown, for example, we'll try to recreate that feel, but in our own way, not exactly the way he did it, because there's no way we could. And I think that Talking Heads and Tom Tom Club are very similar in this way, even though they sound different.
Thank you.